Well, good evening. Welcome to another episode of Let the Truth Be Told. I thank the Lord for being in the studio once again. It took us a minute to get back in here, but I thank the Lord for being in the studio. Thank the Lord for Jason and UPTV and Urbana Public Access for just allowing us another opportunity to be in the studio. My big shots are, and I thank the audience, our listening audience that listen to me every Sunday night and say, Sean, I listen to you every Sunday night. Everybody I run into in the streets and just give me all type of love. I just thank the Lord for you. It's just a blessing just to be have an opportunity to be in front of you once again. I thank the Lord for, I want to just do some house cleaning. Big shouts out to everybody that tuned into this last segment of helping somebody else win and making everybody else to be a winner around you. Just a great show. We ran it a while because it was so impactful, so needed to be able to assist somebody else to be a winner. We're going to do a second episode on that today and just allowing us to have an opportunity to do a second part in helping other people win. And so big shouts out to the Marion family, Mr. Robert Marion. He passed away since our last episode. Great, great older guy, built a great family, and we had a great memorial service for him. Thank the Lord for Mr. Marion, Mr. Robert Marion. Great, great man, great mentor. I wish I had sat around him while he was living, but I learned a lot about him at his passing, and just a great guy. But Miss Marion, oh man, what a blessing. Great, great lady of God, and I thank the Lord for it. Big shouts out to Pastor Shelby and the Salem Missionary Baptist Church, just a great church and great pastor. I thank you very much for the assistance that you have given me during the times that we've reached out to you to help families. So I thank the Lord for you, Pastor Shelby. Continue to do what you do, and happy anniversary to you also, you and your wife. So getting to our program, I thank the Lord for being able to have in the studio my main man, Mr. Donte Lotts. We were in the barbershop on yesterday, the Whip Hair Designs, along with Marshawn, and Marshawn said we better give him a shout out today. And so I'm going to give Marshawn a big shout out. Thanks a lot, cuz, for holding it down for me. We were talking on yesterday, Mr. Donte Lotts. I didn't know which way we were going to go with this this particular segment, but once I seen Donte Lotts, I already knew what direction that the Lord wanted me to go, and that was to talk about the CU Fresh Start program and the things that we have been doing with CU Fresh Start in the city of Champaign, and every leader and every community person that's been involved with the CU Fresh Start and helping somebody else win. And so, Brother Donte, I want you to tell us a little bit about yourself before I go into that. He's been a close friend of mine. I wrote down mentor. He's a backbone of the community. He's also been a part of the Boys and Girls Club, I mean, for many, many years, probably went to the Boys and Girls Club like I did. And if it wasn't for those men and women over there helping us win, we probably wouldn't be sitting here today. Right. And so big shouts out to Jackie, CC, and all those other guys that were involved, Blunt, and all those other guys that were involved into the Boys and Girls Club, the Urban League, Tracy Parsons, and those guys, Reese, and all the people that have been involved in that, Joe Stovall and those guys. He were also a part of the Ready program, and I think I went to the Ready program with him a few times to meet him up there with some of the kids that needed our assistance. Parenting for Love and Limits, he's been a part of that program also. And this brother has had an opportunity to be around the country and see how he can impact the rest of the country and young people. And so that was in Stockton, California. So no further ado, I want to introduce to you Brother Donte Lotts. Brother Donte, pleased to have you on the show today. Yeah, tell sure. The viewing audience a little bit about yourself, and then we'll get to you explaining what is CU Fresh Start and what are we trying to accomplish with CU Fresh Start.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think you captured quite a bit about me. Just adding on to that, you know, I love landscaping. I love peace. you know, I love empowering and uplifting young people and families. I love taking individuals that are coming from a challenging situation, much like I have, and just uplifting them and showing them that they can do it. You know, it's a blessing seeing those individuals later on in life approach you and sincerely thank you for being there for them, and you had to remind them that you were the one that was motivated to make that change to move forward. I was just a support, you know, so putting it back on them so they can own up to their success. But those are the true blessings. I do have a 15-year-old son I'm raising. And, you know, I get presented with challenges. He's a pretty good kid.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's my main focus outside of this new initiative is him and making sure that he continues moving forward, don't get lost, slip through the cracks. You know, as you focusing on the greater community, you got to take care of home. So, you know, I attend Bethel AME Church. Shout out to Pastor Larry Lewis and the members over there. And so I'll just cut it at that because it goes on and on.
You know, and big shouts out to Pastor Lewis and the Bethel CME Church. I mean, just a great church. I thank the Lord for him having leadership and AME Church.
Yeah.
Bethel AME, let's get that together. Bethel AME.
Yeah.
And so my thing is, I thank the Lord for Pastor Lewis and being able to help Marlon Mitchell when he was trying to find his way with the program that he started, the first followers.
Mm-hmm.
And so, and to be able to adapt and say, hey, man, come on in here. And that congregation being able to say, come on in here and accept these brothers and sisters that need a fresh start, that need somebody to wrap their arms around them, show them some love, and get them back started within the community to be productive instead of just letting them trying to find their own way. So I thank the Lord for them just being able to pause for the cause. You know, Brother Donte Lotts, you said some really great things when you said peace and challenges that we have. This community definitely have a lot of challenges that we're facing in the facing of dealing with a lot of the violence that's been going on throughout the community. In the business that I deal with in the funeral home business, unfortunately, sometimes I'm faced with the agony and the pain of all the nuclear fallout of all this violence and dealing with the families directly, dealing with the deceased directly, and dealing with that mentally myself. Mm. It sometimes is very challenging for me because a lot of these young people I know. And so our community is faced with a huge responsibility now to step up on each side of the fences, whether if it's you're on the if you're on the side of being a part of the family that's involved with somebody that's creating this type of scenario for us to deal with, or you're on the part of being the victim of some of this violence that's happening, or you're just on the sideline or just even watching, being a family friend or just being a community person or being a regular citizen that's in a community that's unsafe. And so you tell us what CU Fresh Start is. And what are we trying to accomplish with CU Fresh Start? And why did we design CU Fresh Start for and tailor it for the city of Champaign?
Okay, CU Fresh Start is a gun deterrence, violence deterrence program that is modeled off of the book Don't Shoot, written by David Kennedy. He has a framework and a philosophy in regards to dealing with gun violence in various communities. The book goes through and gives the different accounts, to me, honest accounts of what happened when he went into this city, whether it was issues with politics, you know, community, you know, law enforcement, so on and so forth. And so I think that was helpful for me to actually read through. I took my time going through it and tried to analyze and digest those different scenarios because didn't know what to expect with CU Fresh Start. And so what it is that law enforcement identify individuals that meet five criteria, and that is between the ages of 18 to 28, prior felony conviction, previous gun charge, either on probation or parole, and the last one is credible information that they might be involved in a recent violent crime of some sort. Recent can be as far back as a year. And so that list will vary a couple of months out. Law enforcement identified, I think, close to 40, it might have been about 35 individuals that met that criteria. But we were still evolving CU Fresh Start. And so by the time we got ready to truly identify the first group, we only had a list of 17. One of them we automatically had to take off because they had a warrant. And so one of my questions in that room was, okay, if this person comes to the call-in, will they be arrested? And think it was Anthony Cobb, Chief Cobb, that said, yes, we would have to. And so we automatically took that person off the list. And he was in total agreement with that. Because again, we didn't want this program to get a negative stigma, you know, because there's already gonna be something to it, just how it's set up. And so, and in that, what happened was there was three of us members that were part of the steering committee that went over to Champaign Police Department, law enforcement. There was about four of them in the room. Both chiefs of police were there, Chief Conley as well as Chief Cobb. It might have been Troy Daniels, and there was a third one in there, Dan, I can't remember his last name. And so they gave us the information. They gave us age, they gave us gender, they gave us if they had any type of affiliation with, you know, a gang or a clique. And then they just read through a brief history highlighting the incidents that they have had with these individuals. And so we never got names, they just got numbers. Once we asked all the questions, got all the details we needed, law enforcement left the room. And so it was just myself, Dominic Cobb representing the U of I, and also Reverend Willie Comer. Again, he's a part of the, all three of us are a part of, of the steering committee. And so we we deliberated maybe about 10, no longer than 15 minutes, and we identified 12 names. And so brought law enforcement back in, gave them the numbers, and so then they pulled the packets. And, you know, we had our first group of 12 identified. Well, by the time we got down to the call-in, that list had dwindled down to 9. We were expecting a couple to have some issues anyhow. And so that list had came down to 9. So those were the 9 that showed up in the room. And prior to the call-in, which I know you're going to have me explain in a little bit, I personally went over to probation twice to try to meet with those. They had 5 of the 9 individuals that were on probation, and I had an opportunity to meet with those individuals, let them know what they were going to be walking into, because I didn't want them to walk into something unfamiliar. They're being told or mandated to come to this place and have no clue what's going on. So it was almost like a precursor, gave them an opportunity to ask any questions, get whatever off their chest in regards to their probation officer and what have you. And so I went over there on a Tuesday and then a Thursday prior to the call-in and was able to talk to 5 of those gentlemen. Parole had already contacted their individuals, and so I was unable to connect with those 4 that they had. But that's something that we will be making sure happen, because that's what I want. It's not mandatory, but it's something I feel is important as far as trying to connect with them prior to.
You know, and Brother Donte, give the viewing audience a kind of visual of what that call-in session looked like that Thursday night that we all attended that call-in session. You know, for me, I know being part of the panel and being from the community, knowing these young men and knowing some of the things that went on, it was very touching for me. It was very sensitive. Very emotional. You know, when you got a passion and you love people, you know, I'm a people's person. I love these young people. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm a hood type guy. You know, I mean, I could be professional, but you know, I love the guys that I grew up with. I love the older uncles and the brothers and the stuff that the people that were connected to these young people, and just being able to just talk to them, watch them grow up, and kind of lose their way, mm-hmm. and kind of get in this path of on this trail of going to the penitentiary or maybe being at a funeral home at an early age. It was very impactful and emotional to me. So tell us what that night looked like to you when we got in that room and we seen the actual all the dynamics of what CU Fresh Start looked like and what all those people that came into play to help make this successful.
Walking into the room, you can detect that there was a lot of excitement in the air. I know people had been anxious for this call-in to take place, had been hearing about it, you know, for months, been trying to get information, which was limited. You know, they instructed me not to talk with media, but you know, folks are still gonna try to come at
pull you and
you know, we're bugging Tracy on a daily basis. And so you had media set up in the back of the room. You had, I walked in maybe about 5:30. And of course, the most obvious was the 14 posters that were blown up and then the size on the room, you know, talking about what the individual had done, you know, their consequences as far as the years they have to serve. And of course, seeing those pictures was very touching, because I know at least half of those individuals I was familiar with and worked with. And you always think in your mind, what could you have done possibly different? Right. And so those were the thoughts going through my mind as I walked around the room and took my time looking at each image. You know, I think I might have mentioned to you or someone that if they'd have had pictures of the victims up there as well, I mean, you know, because in this small community, when something happens, you know, like you mentioned, there's going to be the victim, and there's going to be the what would be considered the offender or what have you. And when something happens, whether it's a shooting or a murder, the thought, first thought is, which one of my kids, you know, and which end are they going to be in? Those are the two thoughts that immediately come anytime I hear sirens now, or I'm hearing gunshots, and even around the 4th of July.
Right.
When you're hearing all the fireworks, and it's like, man, it's not even fun anymore.
Yeah.
So that was the immediate thing that hit me. And there was a lot of people in there, but, you know, I wasn't focused on that. You know, I was able to tune all of that out, which is something that I think is important, because I wasn't in this frame of mind of entertaining, you know, the greater crowd. I was truly focused once those nine came in, those nine. And so at 6 o'clock, they did walk the nine gentlemen in into the room towards the front and sat them down. They were facing the panel facing them, and behind them was, you know, approximately 100 people. I think the count was including media. There was a heavy law enforcement presence, which, you know, I'm not super fond on. You know, I feel like, again, this is the first one. People want to get to know what it is. And, you know, these are conversations that I'm going to have with various individuals involved in that. But throughout the panel discussion, you know, again, my main focus was on the nine, their body language, you know, trying to figure out what's going on in their mind, trying to figure out what I'm going to say.
Right.
You know, because I truly didn't write anything down. I really didn't think about what I was going to say outside of the story I told, you know, at the end. But I truly wanted to see, get a feel of what everybody else had to say and try to tailor it to make sense and not be redundant and repetitive. So,
you know, Brother Donte, you know, with the law enforcement presence, I've heard that that argument from different times when we've done community work, whether if it's been from guys from the North End Breakfast Club, or if it's been from the larger base of the community, or if it's been from directly from the African American community. And my personal opinion, you know, I mean, those people, whether they're in the uniform or they're not in uniform, that's their job. They're mm-hmm. still law enforcement, and we can't be intimidated because that's a part of society that mm-hmm. we got to deal with as law enforcement. Now, getting them to play a role and to play a part and let them be a part of this whole scenario and how it plays out and the dynamics of it, that's a whole nother conversation and the roles that they play.
Mm-hmm.
But having them in the room, I think was good, because we have to put forth a stern message to these young men that this is going to be the life that you're going to live forever if you do not first make a choice to change your life right now, because to a person. And I and to me, you know, when you look at Erica Cox walking to the store just to get some knickknacks and on her way home and catch a straight bullet, you know, for that family, they don't care about all that other stuff. You know, for that mother that was raising her, you know, I mean, that was her caregiver. Now she doesn't have a caregiver to show her the love and do the personal attention, the daily attention that she needs, that Erica was giving her every day. Who comes in and fills the gap for her? She doesn't have a choice to whether say she wants this or she wants that or tailor this or tailor that. So I see it in a whole bunch of different dynamics. And so,
And I'll say that I agree. I mean, they have a part in this. My job is to make sure that everything is balanced, that one of the three, because the pillars that you have to make up CU Fresh Start is community. You have services, and you have law enforcement. And so my job is to make sure that those three are balanced as much as possible. And so, you know, that I understand exactly what you're saying. Like I said, when you mentioned the young lady Erica, I had to ride past there every day I go home, you know, and coming from home, I have to ride past that memorial every day until, you know, a month passed and then there was just nothing there, you know. So, you know, my heart goes out to the families and the violence. You know, I've also had the unique privilege of getting to know these gentlemen, you know, and hearing them in the second part that people were not privy to is very powerful to me. Because all of these gentlemen, you know, even though we have shooting going on, are not shooting. They got caught with a gun. You know, why they have a gun, that's a whole different ballpark when you talk about just overall safety.
But you know, being caught with a gun and you being an offender or you maybe already have a felony and getting caught with the gun and then being caught in the actual act of shooting, we don't know if they have been involved, whether directly or indirectly. We just know that they're in the circles.
Absolutely.
We just know that they're in the circles that's causing some of this havoc throughout the community.
Absolutely.
And, you know, for me, even Facebook boxing sometimes, you know, even just the lightweight Facebook boxing I see on Facebook sometimes, you never know the dynamics of what that can bring on. You know, and I always say hurt people hurt people. So you don't know what the next person going through.
And that's a lot of when you read the book Don't Shoot. What's causing all of this gun violence, it's what you just mentioned, the disrespect, social media. You know, we are worldwide now. And so it's not like you and I in a room and I disrespect you, this and that. No. We love making it public, you know. We want to make world star. You know, we got Facebook Live now, you know, where people are.
You can be famous.
Yeah, we recording, you know, we putting the drama out there and it's going to intensify. So, I mean, you're absolutely right. Hurt people are going to hurt people. And so how do you change that whole mindset? Because as I get to know these brothers and sit down with them and let them talk, we got brothers within that nine where there's some shooting that happened between them. So many of them have been shot, and I'm in amazement because you hear about it on the news, but to sit there with a group of nine and almost maybe half of them being shot multiple times is just unbelievable to me. I mean, it just really put me in the presence. So I'm not excusing the behaviors at all, you know, as far as you know, you do something, there's a consequence. But, you know, with my lens and, you know, just having that experience / that social work background, that's where my passion is, meeting folks where they're at and trying to uplift them.
Yeah.
You know, we can focus on the past, but, you know, like that scenario, as long as we hold on to it, you know, those are the traumas. Those are the unhealed wounds that even as adults, we end up struggling with because we didn't deal with it when we were younger, may not have had the capacity, But you got to realize, you know, if you have something, it's not as simple, but if you have something like a father or a dad leaving the mother, and let's say she's pregnant, that can be traumatizing to that unborn baby, because guess what? Now this mother is stressing, and that unborn baby is receiving all of that stress even before it enter into the world. You know, we never know how that's going to play out, but that's the science with all of this. You're talking about like mental health, and you know that whole. I mean, like I said, this gets as deep layers. As you want.
It's several. Yeah. It's many layers.
And so important. It's important for us to try to gain an understanding about this. I'm the type of person, you know, I love constructive criticism. I love the feedback so that we can help grow things and help things make sense.
You know, Brother Donte, I always talk on this program, and I always say I keep it 100, I keep it real. I thank the Lord for being to have an opportunity where I work for the community. Mm-hmm. You know, I everything I do, I work for the community. So I'm for everybody that's out there in the viewing audience. You mm-hmm. know, I'm with y'all. So I keep it 100 real, and my opinion, the views and opinions of Sean's, is this: we neglected addressing these issues for so many years that this is what we're left to deal with. Mm-hmm. I remember when Kiwan died. I never forget that. And I remember when A-Dub and Martell and them kind of put the pressure with media mm-hmm. to find out the dynamics of what's going on, how can we play a role, all of those different things. And I remember going down to my barbershop one day, right after the meeting at the IMC, and I remember a little bird telling us, man, they got a meeting down at the city building, but these guys been meeting at the city building, and these leaders been meeting at the city building for the last 10 years, mm-hmm. and nobody knew it. Mm-hmm. Well, you been meeting, and what you been meeting about? Was it the best interest of the community, or was it a personal gaining meeting? Mm-hmm. Or you built relationships within your own little circle. Mm-hmm. And those things bother me, even bother me to this day. Mm-hmm. So when I look at some of these guys, I look at them totally different than what I used to look at them, mm-hmm. you know. And so my brother Hub always say, let your motives be pure. Mm-hmm. Before we start this program up, we said a prayer, mm-hmm. you know. And so, you know, we want our motives to be pure. We want us to be able to come off to this audience, be able to make a difference. And so whenever you're in a leadership role that you're in, mm-hmm. that some of these other leaders are in, we want to make our biggest bang and our biggest impact so that we can do the bigger good and the better good for community.
Right.
And it's not about what I heard you say. It's not about me. Mm-hmm. It's taking me out of scenario. Now, I got my own personal family. Mm-hmm. But when I'm on the job, mm-hmm. I'm on the job for these guys and do the bigger good for the community and the needs that these young men have.
Right.
And a bunch of them got a bunch of different, various different needs, and they need resources throughout the community.
Yeah.
So I want you to be explain to us what resources out the community do you need to help these guys and to help us have a safe community?
Right. I'm glad you asked that. What I've been trying to do is, with all nine of the gentlemen, they marked that they need jobs. Some of them have jobs currently, but it might be at like a fast food restaurant in which they want a better opportunity.
Right.
As we're talking about helping them change their thinking and their behaviors, we have to give them something tangible to achieve. And so employment, number one. Now, what I did was the call-in happened on that Thursday. That following Tuesday, I was able to get a couple of them to go down to the re-entry resource fair they had at the bus terminal. A couple of them took advantage of that opportunity. They were able to come into a room with multiple resources for them. They had at least 20 or 30 applications, piles of applications, right there on the table.
You talked about employment. And just on employment there, I'm in insurance.
Mm-hmm.
And the definition of insurance is spreading the risk, okay? And so it's a certain risk that these employers are going to have to deal with the history of the young men that they're dealing with.
Mm-hmm.
So how can we assure the employer that these guys have changed their way and that they deserve this opportunity and this mm-hmm. newfound opportunity that we're trying to provide them, and they won't put the business at risk.
Right.
And if something goes wrong or they have a tantrum tantrum, or as my buddy Butter would say, a failure to communicate.
Right. that's where part of my responsibility I feel is, again, as you talk about that key word that I've thrown out there even before I got to position, transparency. And so number one, I have to know these gentlemen and have begin to know them on a more intimate individual basis. All right. With that information, going back to the reentry resource fair that happened, I was circulating the room as well.
Okay.
And so I had made connections with individuals over at the Illinois Employment Training Center that offer job training.
Okay.
One of the gentlemen that marked that they want employment also marked job training. And when I brought him in, met with him one-on-one, I asked him, I said, what made you mark job training? He said, because I think I need some skills, you know, in order to be employed. Yeah. And I asked him then, I said, well, have you ever worked? He's like, yeah, I worked at Subway. And I said, what happened? He was like, you know, after a while, just got tired of people coming in talking sideways.
Yeah.
And see, I worked at the bus terminal, you know, and that first floor gets off the chain as far as different people coming from out of town.
All different walks of life.
All type of people coming in. So I understood, because individuals that would be considered living a normal life have had to do something different, you know, with that. And so, again, it just goes back to assessing where they're at. You know, it's all about building social skills and helping them change their way of thinking. But again, also offering that outlet to mentor in various capacities. And so being a support for them as they're on the job, you know, if something comes up, them being able to call your phone and opposed to them walking off the job, you know, let's talk about how can you handle that. You know, let's come up with a plan. And so if you're unable to come up with that yourself, knowing that you got support and a trusted individual is so important, you know, because a lot of these guys, and you know, as a parent, I know this even recently, as parents, you can tell your young folk something and they not get it or want to get it, but then you have somebody different tell that same statement or what have you, and it's going to register just like that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And so again, it's just walking them through.
Yeah.
Walking them through again. Some of them are already there and ready to be employed and motivated. Others are going to need that encouragement.
And you know, what I hear you saying is that during the last statement is these guys connect to whoever the messenger are.
Absolutely.
It depends on who the messenger is.
And,
you know, and
I'm sorry.
If you never been through nothing, you know, and trying to connect with these guys, you know, you probably need to put somebody else on the team
right. That's
been through something that can kind of relate. So what I'm hearing.
Let me, before we lose the thought, because you asked about what resources, we talked about employment.
Mm-hmm.
Also, I'm going to say there are some that don't have their license for various reasons. So
okay.
I have to journey through that and see what's what. I even went to court with one of them this past week.
Okay.
Offering that support, you know, going to the courtroom.
Right, right.
So I can just be in tune with what's going on with them. And that's something I've done in my previous jobs as well. And finally, housing.
Okay.
Housing in regards to conversations with housing authority, conversations with private landlords, you know, folks that can invest in this population and not just giving them anybody that does not have any income coming in.
Right.
But giving them the opportunity in regards to something may have happened years ago where someone lost their Section 8.
Right.
You know, going back, figuring out what happened, what can be done to restore that situation. Because we had 8 out of 9 sign up up until yesterday, yesterday I got the last one to sign up. And the primary thing that he told me was, look, can you get me housed? Me and my mom are in different living situations, you know. He's 19, he's working. We're in different living situations. You know, what he's telling me is, I need to be with my mom under the same roof.
Right, right, right.
Under the same roof. But their brother held out 2 weeks.
Right.
And last night, I sat over his house waiting on him for an hour and a half. He finally showed up, and I had to walk him through what this was, remind him who I was, because I connected with him back when he was 6 or 7.
Okay.
And remind him who I was, and none of that has changed. I'm here to work for you, pretty right. much. And he finally signed. And I told him what me and his mom had talked about prior to him coming and what I'm gonna work on. But then the sister was asking questions about the expungement coming up.
Yeah, yeah.
And then there was a friend of the family asking that.
Yeah.
And then somehow he mentioned CDLs.
Yeah.
And I said, look, man, I got a guy that's getting ready to train to do CDLs for free.
Yeah, yeah.
You have to pay the $150 for the test.
Yeah.
But guess what? That $5,000-$6,000, you don't have to worry about.
Yeah, yeah.
These are blessings that are happening and people that are stepping up, you know, but it's like we never have enough because you never know what these 9 young men and their family and friends, because it's not just those 9. If we limit it to just those 9s, we're going to continue having call-ins on a more consistent basis, and that's something we almost want to work away from.
You know what, Brother Donte, I mean, as I'm listening to the story, and I'm putting faces with the story, you know what I'm saying? And for me, you can count on me. I'll sponsor one of those guys. If it's just $150,
mm-hmm.
We got, my brother Joe Stovall told us one night at a North End Breakfast Club meeting, he said, you got to have some skin in the game.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what you're asking for, skin in the
Absolutely.
Game. You're asking for us all as a community to help solve an issue that's going
right.
on. And because one thing about it, this community, and it makes me mad about this community, we'll talk about folk.
Mm-hmm.
We'll talk about folk. We'll kick them while they're down. We'll say we got this issue. We won't address the issue. We won't come to no community meetings. We'll sit on our couches. We'll be in the back room. We'll be behind the crowd. But nobody wants to step up.
Right.
And so what you're asking for is housing.
Mm-hmm.
We know guys out there that got houses out there, that got multiple houses, got a bunch of houses. And so I'm making the plea to you guys right now because a lot of y'all watch me every Sunday night.
Mm.
Man, reach out to this brother and get these folks a house. If that's all that brother's hurting about and he's frustrated because him and his mama can't be under the same dwelling so that they can reconnect and build, because there's a lot of underlying issues that they're trying to deal with probably personally to themselves
mm-hmm.
and frustration. Hurt people, man.
Mm-hmm.
And when you get out, when you get hurt, and then we don't even have the resources, the mental health that we need. So our mental health is the red fox or the red box or whatever the story is called. And we going to get some drink.
Yeah.
And once social media and the environment that we have created get into play, and then we popping pills and we doing all this stuff that's readily available. And you know, pharmaceutical companies have already had their role into it. Now street pharmacists have had their role into it. Now that plays on a role, and it could have all been stopped because we could have provided the resources that Dante's asking for right now for these young men that's on the brink. They on a seesaw.
Right.
Whether they gonna go this way or they gonna go that way. And I ran into a lot of these guys, man, that don't have nothing to live for. They died at age 21,
mm-hmm.
but they still living. But they died at 21.
Right.
We just ain't buried them yet.
Right.
Because their dreams had died. Their hope in people done died.
Right.
They been let down so many times. When you have a dad that walk out on you,
mm-hmm.
you got uncles and aunts that have walked out on you, the people that's supposed to love you the most. You got teachers then that you thought that loved you, that walked out on you, that
mm-hmm.
told you something that was hurtful. I love what I do. Oh my goodness, I love what I do. Sometimes it's hard to do what I do.
Mm-hmm.
But I was at an insurance appointment on yesterday. And I kind of videotaped it afterwards, just my response afterwards, winding mm-hmm. down, just to put it out there. But, you know, I sat with this lady and I was talking to her about the importance of having life insurance. And she started telling me, you know, Sean, you know, I got a 19-year-old son, I got an 18-year-old son, 17-year-old son, and a 16-year-old boy, I think. And the 16-year-old just didn't stop going to school. Mm. He ain't going to school at all. Mm. And so after I start talking to her about some personal things with me and what my life had brought me here and there, she said, you know what? I wish you could talk to my kids. And I said, well, after we finish this paperwork, I told the other young man, go get your brothers, mm-hmm. bring them on back. Mm-hmm. So we sat down afterwards, finished the paperwork up, getting them some insurance, and I was able to talk to him. I went to him, you know, I keep it 100 real. You know, some of you guys maybe can't come like that because if you ain't been nothing, you ain't seen nothing, you can't come like that.
Right.
So I kept it to him straight 100 real. And so dude said, yeah, I know you. You want Mr. Whip. You got that in the air rest. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, the old school. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because you got to have something they can touch, see it, feel it. Mm-hmm. When you touch it, you see it, you feel it. Okay, I didn't always have that, man. Mm-hmm. People done told me what I couldn't do. They counted me out. They said you wasn't going to do this, you wasn't going to do that. But let me tell you what God got for you, man.
Right. Absolutely.
Get what the devil has stole from you. Don't let the devil snatch your education from you at 16. Mm-hmm. Because I wish I had paid more attention in school. And so we'll let the devil play a role in our folks instead of having enough love to say, I'm not going to let the devil steal my kid. Mm-hmm. We'll let our nieces go away. We'll say, oh, they just bad, they this, they that. We'll start getting on the bandwagon with the crowd that don't love them at all.
Right.
Instead of playing the role you're supposed to be the person that stood in the gap and say, I'm going to ride this ship all the way with you.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where I see us at right now. But you know, when we finish with the young man, he told me, one of the young men said, he said, the 16-year-old said, man, I'm going to be at school tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to be at school tomorrow. I'm glad you came over here.
Right.
Mom was sitting over there teary-eyed.
Mm-hmm.
Because as we was talking about insurance, because she know that her kids involved into a lifestyle that might that she knows she might need this insurance.
And we got to follow up with that. You know, because that conversation is something to motivate.
Yeah.
But as you know, as an adult, somebody telling you something and being there constantly for you, and it might not, I'm not saying just you,
yeah.
But I'm just saying
just
we as a community have to be more involved in that. And that's just what it is, man. You know,
Brother Donte, the more emotional part with me was, just that 45 minutes to an hour being at that household, you know, and I didn't have a lead or anything to go over that household. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm trying to perfect myself and just randomly going up to a door knocking and say, do y'all need some insurance?
Mm-hmm.
And the Lord just sent me over to that household. Mm-hmm. I seen the lady moving around in the yard and I knocked on the door.
Right.
And so being at just after that hour visit and sitting there talking to the 19-year-old mm-hmm. and telling him what I do and how I came from the bottom,
mm-hmm.
you know, and he said, you know what, man? You like a father I never had.
Thank you.
And there's so many young guys out there that need some male role model, some guy on the block. But so many of us so distracted on our own personal gain, our own personal life,
right.
that we don't care about the guy down the street no more. Man, I thank the Lord I had so many different guys on the block when my dad wasn't there.
Yep.
You know, I know these hurts that these guys are having.
Right.
You know, I don't get so bottled up on them.
Mm-hmm.
But some people need more than others. You know, my girl able to explain that to me right now. You know, some people need more than what you needed, Sean.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm able to see it a little bit different, you know, because, you know, I thank the Lord for military and all these other things, compartments that I didn't connect myself with to help me build me back up. But, you know, some people need more things than others. And some of these guys right now, they need a Donte Lotts or they need some programs that's in place.
And what you're talking about, Sean, simply in one word is empathy. The ability for us to truly understand and relate, the ability to put ourselves in somebody's shoes,
yeah.
being able to put yourself in that 16-year-old's shoes,
yeah.
listening to them. A lot of times we come in a room, and I keep telling people, too many times we come in a room and we lecture kids.
Yeah.
We want them to listen. We lecture. They get that enough at school. They get that at home.
Yeah.
Guess what? They want a place to come in where they can talk. Part two of the call-in was the most powerful out of everything that went down, and people were not privy to that conversation. But when that first part of the call-in was over, walked them over to the other room, that's when the real dialogue started. That's when those gentlemen had an opportunity to speak to law enforcement, tell their story. You know, it's more to it than I got a felony, I got a gun charge. Guess what, Chief Cobb? Let me tell you what's really going on with me. First of all, yes, I had a gun, number one. Number two, I had my FOID card. Number three, I happened to have a gun serial number scratched off of it, okay? And I got caught with that. Then I can go into telling you why I had the gun. Guess what? I'm dating a young lady and her ex while I was out like that.
Right, right.
You know, I ain't just walking around wanting a gun, this and that, wilding out like that. I'm talking about safety and all these threats. Guess what I'm going to get? Boom. And so that's just one scenario. And again, not excusing what it is, but being able to meet them right there and be like, hey, what could we have done differently?
Or being able to see the environment that these guys are living in, the people that they got to live in. I was listening to Urban Talk Radio on XM Radio, and a guy said something that was very important, and it was a white guy. He said, nobody signs up to stay in the ghetto.
I'm telling you.
Don't nobody sign up and say, man, I want a house in the ghetto. give me the most raggedy house in the ghetto.
Yeah, man.
Nobody signs up for that. I mean, you know, and I remember, I think, when a judge had ordered maybe an attorney or something to go, or a mayor or something, or somebody to go stay in the projects for 30 days.
That's so powerful.
And so when he came up out of that 30-day sentence, he was a different guy.
I'm telling you.
Because of the fact that he was forced to stay in the ghetto.
Right.
And so when I listen to the larger base of the community, I'm listening to 1400, and they saying, I can't believe
this. Man, you're not going to believe it.
You cannot. You can't even understand the dynamics. You ain't never had to pat roaches off your arm, and you ain't never had to, you know, flies everywhere, and you never had to have where it's gunshots going off. And, you know, I stayed in the inner city of Detroit off 8 Mile. I stayed off 8 Mile, you know, when I was at. And man, it was a guy that shot his guns off every night because he bought guns.
Man.
You know, it was guys selling drugs, and you better not say nothing.
I'm telling you.
You know, it was people, it was, you know, it was, the Detroiters was a different environment, you know, and this was back in the early 90s, and we seeing it now around the country, but they've been dealing with this since the early 90s, where you got to protect yourself at the grocery store because it's folks that can't get groceries.
Right. What's the thing where they stay all night? Downtown Champaign in the winter?
A winter's night out.
Okay, now, it's a difference knowing you guys spend one night doing that. I could go do that.
I did it a couple years.
I could go do that, but then imagine, you said 30 days with the brother. Imagine staying out all winter time for 30 days.
And I keep it straight 100 across the board. Hey, I think it was that first or that second year. I went to Walmart and I got Pastor Johnson and the mayor, and there was some different stuff, and then all of a sudden it started raining.
I'm telling you.
And it was cold. You know what I told him? Good luck.
Yes, sir.
I'll see y'all tomorrow.
Man, that's
because
real.
Because they the roles that they were playing, and then the commitment that they had. You know, how many of us can stand in there and then do that because you're forced to do it?
Absolutely.
See, these guys are forced to be in that environment. And then, you know, I mean, when you'd had somebody shooting at you a whole week, you know, you might have called the police, but you'd have had somebody shooting at you. You'd have had somebody on your phone threatening you, threatening your girl. You know, what are you doing in those type of scenarios? You know, I mean, you got to come out the house. You know, you can only stay in the house so long. Right. You know, the police saying, well, we can't do nothing about it until he actually do something. Well, he actually got to kill
me. Man, I'm telling you.
You know, I actually got to be in a victim and in a body bag.
I'm telling you, man.
You know, so now you're forced as a person to have to do something. You know, and it reminded me of a brother that came to the barbershop early one morning, had been out all night. And the hood called it trapping, but we know it's called hustling. And he told me, he said, Sean, he said, man, I don't want to do this.
Right.
He said, man, I'm tired of going to the penitentiary. He said, man, but I can't get no job.
Yep.
He said, I went to the temporary service, man. They told me my felony got to be gone 7 years before they can give me some help.
Man.
He said, man, I can't even get no respect from my girl at home.
Man, Jack.
And I ain't got no money. She got the Section 8. It's her crib. She got a car, she getting all these resources,
and I ain't
got nothing.
It's hard.
So in order for me to get my respect back out, my woman and my kids, I got to bring something to the table.
And it's hard, Sean, for people to understand that. I had a young man reach out to me Monday and said, look, man, he said, I done went to jail, then came out, been working 2 years. You know, he works at a local restaurant. He said, but I'm trying to get on at the U of I. He said, I applied. He said, I passed all the, I qualified for many jobs out there. I got this felony on my record. He said, can you write me a character letter, letter of recommendation? I said, absolutely. So he had his meeting yesterday at 11 o'clock. And I had sent it to him via email about a quarter till.
Yeah.
I'm like, where are you meeting at? He told me, where was that? I said, man, I'm coming bringing his hard copy. So 10:58, I'm dropping off the hard copy. He'd already went in the room, but the lady gave him to him. He was like, I got it, you know, this and that.
Yeah.
The brother sent me something later, man. He's great to get a job out there.
That's excellent.
That brings me so much joy for him. And this is, again, one of my shorties ago. He was one of my first teenagers when I worked at the Boys and Girls Club.
Yeah.
You know, but it's stories like that.
Yeah.
My pockets might be empty.
Yeah.
I barely can get a line in once a week or whatever the case might be. But the joy come with stories like that, the breakthroughs.
You know what? Just words of encouragement just for you, Donte. And I tell this to my brother Hub all the time because you have a special, calling on his life for young people and kids.
Mm-hmm.
And when I had the restaurant, me and my mom, we didn't make a lot of money.
Right.
We went into a lot of debt, actually.
Mm-hmm.
And when I explained it to my mom, you know, because you get in the business to make a lot of money,
right,
is that what you think sometimes?
Mm-hmm.
But what happened afterwards was the best thing that could ever happen to me, is when my mom got around her friends and her brothers and her sisters, and the glow that went into her eyes to say, my son Sean helped me get an opportunity in my lifetime to own a business,
right,
to be able to cook that sweet potato pie and that stuff and give it to the community. And that time that me and Carlos and Mama, you know, sat back and we cooked and we gave food away during that Thanksgiving time to homeless people and things of that nature, and she bring that up, that's a $1 million smile.
That's right.
You know, and those are the things that we can give back to our people, you know, during their lifetimes.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to say a lot about your dash.
Because
as I started that program out talking about Robert Marion.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason why his homegoing celebration was at a different level because of his lifestyle.
Mm-hmm.
And so what Pastor Johnson said to me one day, he said, man, how could you rest in peace when you didn't live in peace?
Mm-hmm.
And you mentioned that earlier in the program, it's about peace.
Mm-hmm.
Those celebration of life services that go off the meat rack,
mm-hmm,
it's because those people lived off the meat rack.
Right.
They gave to people. They loved on people. They weren't selfish. Mm-hmm. The big house on the hill wasn't just for them.
That's right.
To share with everybody else.
That's right.
The big car that they got, that the Lord provided, was for somebody else. It wasn't for themselves.
Absolutely.
And too many of us have become selfish.
Mm-hmm.
And so I thank the Lord for the big heart that you have. You know, it might not come with a lot of bread.
Absolutely.
It might not come with a lot of bread, you know, so it might not come with a big old check. One day, God going to bless you with that, too.
That's it.
He's going to bless you with that, too.
Right.
Because if he owns everything, you're going to get you something because you got connected.
I know that's right.
And so I'm going to claim that.
Absolutely.
On your life, because once you start, because what I try to always reach back and I always try to tell these guys that take off and do well, always reach back.
Mm-hmm.
So as Sergio McClain called me this past week and said, Brother Sean, I know you're doing the insurance. I'm doing a basketball training and I'm trying to do this, showing these guys how to do this mentorship and all this here with guys with basketball.
Mm-hmm.
And big shout out to the McClain family. On this past week, they celebrated the passing of Coach McClain.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Sergio's trying to get back to the community.
Right.
And so I thank the Lord for him trying to come back and reach back.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you didn't make it to the level that you thought you might have made it to.
Right, right.
But to be able to get to a place where you say, I want to get back to this community that gave me something.
Right.
You know. And so those are the things that I get ecstatic about and I believe in wholeheartedly is giving back to the community, because Sean can be doing what Sean doing if it wasn't for the brothers in the hood.
Right.
I didn't have the people speaking in tongues, saved, sanctified, filled with the precious gift of the Holy, whoop, whoop, up the bam, to me. Mm-hmm. They good people. They just didn't shop with me coming in the door.
Right.
You know, it was the brothers with the Carhartt suits on that stood on the corner that everybody said wasn't good people.
Right.
But I done seen some good in them guys.
Absolutely.
I done seen some stuff when I done called on the phone and I done called down there and asked for the do-gooders to help me. Mm-hmm. And it was a brother from the hood that said, hey, man, I heard you got that funeral for that baby man that tragically died.
Right.
He said, here go 300. And when I go home, I'm going to bring you 300 more. Mm-hmm. And I called the do-gooders and they said, well, you know, just to get a family my condolences.
Mm-hmm.
But we ain't got nothing over here.
Mm-hmm.
You know you had some,
mm-hmm.
even if it wasn't but some mentorship or some prayer.
Right.
Some good word.
Absolutely.
Do what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
Volunteers, that, Brother Joe told me it's called sweat in the game.
Yes, sir.
Put some sweat in the game. So in closing, give us some closing remarks, something that the community can do to try to participate in helping your program be a success.
Okay. Well, first of all, I want to give you my number, 217-954-8262. Again, that's 217-954-8262. I am open to the community. I'm open to any question, comments, resources in regards to CU Fresh Start. This is something that I do. We are in a spiritual warfare, and
yes,
the good is going to win in the end. So just like I have to be reminded, keep your head up, and let's not focus so much on the past. Let's focus on moving forward.
That's right. You know, Brother Donte, as we get ready to close this program out, I thank the Lord for everybody that view our program. Man, I really appreciate you taking the time out of your schedule to come over here and share a little bit about CU Fresh Start with us. You know, as we go into this election that's about to happen, you know, what I would tell everybody in the community, larger based community, all my vets that's out there, don't let this election divide us racially. We're all in this together. We're all one common denominator. We're Americans.
Mm-hmm.
We're Americans. We all live by each other. We all live into a community. We all live in the United States of America. Let's come together. Don't let one person or two different people, not saying one way Republican, one way Democrat, don't let them divide us up from the things that we have accomplished already. And so don't let this take us back. Let's look forward. It's a reason why the front window bigger than the rear view. We ain't gonna blame anybody for any mistakes. Let's just all dig in and whatever we can do personally to make our lives and our community and our country better, dig in and make it better. And it all starts at home. Each one teaching one right at your house and let that spread abroad. So I thank the Lord for everybody tuning into us every Sunday night and they come up to me and say, Sean, I watch your program every Sunday night. Peace. Thanks for another episode of Let the Truth Be Told.